These people were doing these things either one of two ways, either through the power of Satan, which we know can turn himself into an angel of light. He has abilities. He's obviously not God, but he can do certain things and show certain signs. It's either that or through deception, the same way we see magicians today pull a rabbit out of a hat or things like that. There are things you can do to deceive the eye, right? So regardless, the point is that these people who were not of the truth were able to perform signs. So in the same way, again, we don't know this Shlomo Yehuda personally or anything like that. But if they're attributing miracles to him, I would just caution people about how attributing things can be done. God.
You are now listening to the Hold Your Point podcast, a platform dedicated to discussing millennial culture and experience through a Christian lens. Redefining who we are with cultural excellence and as children of the Most High. Cultivating thought-provoking discussion and spreading the word of God with love. Hold your point.
Good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Peace to the planet. This is the Hold Your Point podcast. We are the Hold Your Point podcast crew. My name is Fortunato, and you know I got the fellas in the house, man, for a very super-powered hour. We got Levi Strauss, Michael Joseph, DJ DTH. What's going on, fellas?
What's happening, y'all?
Glad to be here.
Hey,
as always.
Second to the last run of the year. We got one more to close out this year.
Yeah, man.
This year is done already.
Dang. Look where we come from, man. Making strides.
Hey, for real.
Your moves, making strides.
By the grace of God alone.
Amen.
Hey, so we got a good episode, man, that we want to jump right into. I know before we do so, man, Lee Strauss got us with a super packed segment. So you know, I don't know what he got for us, man. We're gonna take a look, see what's going on.
For sure. Let me take it away for y'all, man. So we got a little topic here we're gonna discuss. But before we get into that, you know, I just want to share a little something with y'all. So I want to know what y'all think about this real quick.
Pastors, are you ready? You want something? Take it! That's yours tonight! You want it? You want it? Take it! You want it tonight? Take it! The power of the Holy Ghost! Take it! Oh, take it! Take it! Take it! And the power of the Holy Ghost! The anointing of the Holy Ghost! You want it? You want it?
Boy. Hey, look.
That sound like Kane's theme music from WWE.
Yeah, I mean, real quick about that, you know, I just feel like, you know, he was doing this thing and he probably got a little caught up in what he was going on. But I want to know what y'all thoughts are on people who actually, like, you know, portray these kind of messages, portray these kind of, you know, actions in Christianity and church or whatever. Like,
before the fellas jump on in, for folks who might be just listening, What did we just witness?
I'm pretty sure you witnessed the guy who's in church and he is expressing his devotion, his power, I guess, through, you know, blessings and all that. But, you know, I don't know about y'all, but it looked a little crazy to me when he was, you know, just stretching his hand and people are falling all over the place. It didn't seem genuine to me. I don't know, but I don't. At the same time, it was also, you know, a little funny. But at the same time, it's like, I don't know how people get into that kind of space where they can kind of just follow someone's, you know, direction out of that, you know?
Yeah, man, you had the pastor throwing blessings from the pulpit all in the crowd in different directions. I thought some of them was about to start swag surfing the way that they was moving in unison. It's like anything goes nowadays. This had to be after they collect the offering, because I don't see nobody coming back from that.
It definitely makes you think a little bit, like, what goes on in some of these churches. Like, I don't know if this is an American church or not, but it's like, sometimes you think, like, what's going on? Like, what are y'all doing?
Well, it's a touchy ground, man, because, you know, it's what he's trying to portray is, you know, I'm going to be the neutralist here and say it's a touchy ground because everybody received the Holy Ghost in different ways. Now, it could be in the sense that they're in the spirit and we don't know, you know what I'm saying? Or it could be that they actually put on a show for live TV, you know what I mean? But I don't know.
You know what? I'm going to follow up on Mike, and I'm going to say this because it actually just hit me actually a little bit before he was talking. with the way, like, of course, things that we aren't familiar with is always going to seem foreign, right? Like, I'll never forget when we went to England or Europe. Okay, I'm not going to touch on that. But what came in my mind was, like, with a lot of churches that we know, when they do praise breaks, right?
Okay.
Is there a difference between the two? Because somebody can jump off in a praise break and just kind of just fall with what everybody else is doing, yeah. Right? So I'm just trying to throw a little wrench to the whole situation here. So
of course we come from a church where we've seen people move the whole bench when they catch the Holy Ghost. They just reconstruct the whole church.
For me, man, I just want to give props to whoever made that video, adding in the Avatar music, was a stroke of genius. It made the thing so hilarious. And as we described, for those who weren't able to see, is this preacher, and he's just from the pulpit throwing his hands into the crowd, and people are falling like all over themselves. And it's quite a sight to see. So as far as my reaction to it, I think it's foolishness. It's again, you can look at it different ways, but I've never seen. I mean, this man would have to be quite special to have a power where he can throw his hands in their direction and their bodies are literally falling.
Whole over. Section of the amphitheater.
Chairs, and everything.
Yeah, that was nice.
It's the whole crowd is doing it. So I mean, that's
except the cameraman and the musicians. So you know the musicians.
They need them.
We ain't paying you for that, brother.
I want to point out something. Don't you notice that there was like those yard chairs though? They weren't nothing but like benches,
like the picnic chairs.
That's how I knew it wasn't there. I'm just like, okay. But
something I definitely want to bring up is like I would hope this is not like some kind of like depiction of how people would think Christians are, or like, let's say I was in that congregation and I'm just going to stand there. I'm not actually going to fall. I'm just going to stand there and look at you. Like, I would love to know what the reaction would be. Like, yeah, you know, like, do I not have the spirit, or am I not in the Holy Ghost?
They're going to be like, come with me, brother. You don't belong in this.
Some of the new folk in the back up top, some of them ain't fall. That's why they put them up top.
They put them in the back. Y'all ain't gonna fall.
I love Sister Lewis. We know that you ain't falling. Man. We gonna need you to get to the top.
We got a special recording this evening.
Yeah, man. Yeah. I mean, yeah. Then you gotta let people follow you. All right. I'm sorry.
Nah, you good. I mean, you know, it's a lot of different things we're seeing, you know, as of late with pastors and churches. And, you know, I mean, we hope everything is done in the correct fashion, man. So, you know, someone who truly come there to get their blessing amongst, you know, all the theatrics. But, you know, we leave the rest to God. We put our slight 2 cents on it, man, and we keep moving. So, But you know, we got a real deep episode we want to talk about tonight, man. This evening, this afternoon, this morning, whenever you're listening. And you know, we want to talk about the Messiah that, you know, some of these folks are proclaiming to have come in Israel. You know, and I'm not sure if many people have seen it. His name is Yehuda Shlomo Yehuda, something like that. I know the Shlomo part is in there. So you Google Shlomo, you'll find some videos of him. But, you know, there's you know, just a lot of people following this individual around, you know, and claiming that he's the Messiah, claiming that he's doing miracles in Israel. And I even seen, you know, some rabbis in NYC climbing the little dirty light poles in New York and posting pictures saying the Messiah's return. So, you know, this is definitely something that we haven't seen before, even though the Bible talks about, you know, false prophets, not to automatically go on to women, call the man a false prophet. But, you know, it's definitely things that we've been taught to look for as these times come, man. So we want to talk about, you know, Mr. Shlomo in Israel, you know what I'm saying, doing this thing, got people following him around like Michael Jackson with the baby blanket. And, you know, we want to just get the fellas' take on it, man, and see what y'all think about it. Is this something that's aligning with the Bible? Is it another piece of prophecy like we've seen with the Euphrates River? You know what I'm saying? What y'all think so far?
So what is it about him that is so that's drawing people to him? What are they saying about him?
Miracles, right? Didn't they say like he did some miracles for like a child that was sick or something? He healed like a child.
Okay.
Yeah, and even before that, I think they're saying like he memorized the I was about to say the Quran. Lord have mercy. He memorized the Torah. I was looking at a different video. He memorized the Torah. But no, they said like he memorized the Torah at like 12 years old or some age as a child. And not only the Torah, but there's some other like, you know, like Hebrew or Jewish books that he memorized at a really young age and, you know, was able to recite these things. Supposedly they said like, you know, since a child, he's never had his head uncovered. You know, that was another thing that I seen. And it was some other things, I guess, like, you know, to kind of say, like, he was been prepped since a child for, like, you know, this type of moment or this, you know, for this to come.
My question is, you know, like, DJ, so, like, how do you know where this comes from originally? Who ordained him to be this, you know what I'm saying? Because these are just, what are people saying, but where is the original source from it?
Yeah, well, I mean, I'm not entirely sure exactly like all the things he did, but I know there's definitely like miracles and stuff that we're talking about. I guess my whole issue with it is if he's claiming to do these miracles by his own power, or if he's claiming to do these things on his own. I mean, does he call upon the word of God when he's claiming to do these things, or when he's preaching, or when he's reciting the word of God? You know, I just feel like as long as if he's not giving honor to glory to God, then that is definitely an issue there. It's definitely a false prophet type of issue there, I want to say. But yeah, I'm not entirely sure of all the things he did, but based on what I'm hearing, I mean, he's getting a bunch of clout from a bunch of the Israel leaders, and I guess if he's not denying it, like in terms of saying like, you know, he's not the, you know, the Messiah and stuff like that, then there's an issue for me, you know?
Yeah. I agree with that. And it's, to me, it reminds me a lot of the Pope, because in a way, Catholic folks look towards the Pope as, I believe, that the representation of God on earth. And I always just find it so crazy because I'm like, the Pope, this man knows in his heart that there ain't nothing divine about him. And yet he's receiving this adulation and this praise from people when he knows in his heart he has these crazy evil thoughts the same way rest of us do. But yet you're going to accept the praise and stuff. So in the same way, this man, Shlomo Yehuda, he's being talked about as potentially a Messiah to the Israeli folks. And I'm just wondering, again, I haven't heard much from him directly, whether he's claiming to be the Messiah or if he's rejecting these claims that people are putting upon him. But, you know, there's a saying that's, what is it? Silence is acceptance. So if you're not saying anything against it, mm-hmm. then that's basically saying, yeah, that's me, but it's kind of saying it without him having to say it. He's like, I got these people to say it for me. So, I mean, if that's what's going on, as Lee just said, I think that's a problem, because we'd obviously be wrong. And there's a lot of ways we can prove that. And for me, my mind goes to the Jewish leaders. These people are supposed to be learned in the Torah and the Talmud, which they also use. But
that was the other book, yeah.
Yeah, with all the prophecies in the Bible about the Messiah, I wonder how is it that they look at some of them? Because I suppose there just must be some of them that they just discount, like being born of a virgin and being born of during a certain time period that only the Messiah could come in. That time is thousands of years ago that the Messiah had to come. So I'm like, what is it about this guy that makes them think which prophecies is he fulfilling? So that's where my mind goes.
Yeah, and the thing is, too, I think with, like, Judaism, or, you know, with most of them, like, in the land as it is right now, they don't believe that the Messiah is coming back as a divine person. Like, they believe that it's going to be just a regular man who, you know, is good and, you know, what have you. So I think that's why there's a lot more of them, like, following as well, because of their belief of who the Messiah is going to be as he returns. So it's like, you know, how Christianity, how we believe it, we believe Jesus is coming back, he's going to break the clouds and so forth, but they just believe that Jesus was a prophet or a good man, and the Messiah returning again, just to, you know, reemphasize, is just going to be a regular person.
Yeah, I mean, I think it'll be it's kind of difficult, because I think there's actually a language barrier there, so even if he is saying something, I don't think we're going to know what he's saying unless we have these translations from, you know, so it gets filtered from someone else's opinion, basically. But the way I always see things, in my eyes, you're usually innocent until proven guilty. That's the way, like, I usually run my life, right? And people that surround me. And then there's another thing that, like, we got to realize, like, there's always two sides to everything, right? So we know that this world is full of evil, full of wickedness. Right. So The opposite side of that has to be light, has to be good. So I hope, like, this brother isn't saying, like, he's the Messiah. And then people are just putting that title on him, you know, because, hey, look, I was given a nickname when I was in school. I didn't call myself that, but everybody started calling me this. And I don't need to put it out there what that nickname is. But
yeah, but that's the thing, though. Like, if it was something bad that you didn't like, you know what I'm saying? You would refute it every chance that you get. Like, don't call me that. That's not my name. You know what I'm saying? But yeah.
What's going on? He seems like from what I've seen, he seems like a, you know, a soft spoken person where he's not really going to, you know, get out of pocket and, you know, scream down the place, but, you know, we'll monitor.
Yeah, and then the, you know, accepting possibly of a nickname is one thing, but when you start allowing people to kiss your hand and, you know what I'm saying, kiss you everywhere, and it's like, you just, you know what I'm saying, you accepting it all, like, it comes with the territory, I'm just gonna live and bask in the moment type thing, like, you know, it's dangerous, man, especially, like, when you know what people are calling you, and you know what the law says if you have it memorized.
Yeah, I think that's the point. Is it's one thing, like you said, a nickname, but I mean, it's not just any nickname these people are calling them, right? Like, this is the savior of what they believe, just the Jewish people, but the savior of the world, really. And, you know, you should not be accepting of that type of adulation and praise, because the glory should only be going to God. And so, you know, if you're not, I don't see how you're not denying that unless you think you're God. So, you know, that's an issue. If in fact he hasn't, you know, denounced these claims about him, which, again, I haven't seen enough to know if he has come out and categorically denied, hey, I'm not that, I'm just a regular guy. But if all these other Jewish leaders and the top of the top Jewish leaders are looking at this guy like this, then there must be something about him where they see something in him and he himself thinks he sees something.
How much merit do we give some of these like Jewish leaders to? Is that, you know, do we think like that's credible, right? As far as these Jewish leaders like are literally saying that this brother is different than the rest. He's, this brother is a Messiah. Like, do we even like, do we give credit to some of these Jewish leaders? What y'all think?
I was just about to bring something like that up. Like, I think it's pretty dangerous when, you know, a guy like that is might be taking on the, you know, praise and adoration, because it leads back into this in the future or in prophecy. There's going to be what we call the man of sin, the son of perdition, that guy. And he's going to come and deceive the world. The Bible says he's going to come and deceive the very elect, if you were to choose to, at the end times. I mean, look at 2 Thessalonians verse 3. It says, let no one deceive you by any means, for that day will not come unless the falling away comes first and the man of sin is revealed, the son of perdition. And then there's a couple of attributes that, like, I think should be attributed when you're looking at a guy like that. And it says, who opposes and exalts himself above all that is called God or that is worship. Mm-hmm. So that he sits as God in the temple of God, showing himself that he is God. So, I mean, a couple of things to break down there. One, he has to be opposing God. Two, he has to be exalting himself. I mean, there is that, you know, mention of him sitting in the temple of God. You know, I know now they don't really even call it the temple of God, but you know, he's going to be in that space, you know. So a couple of different attributes. I don't know if he applies to all these things. So in my head, it's not even him. Like, I don't really take him as a super serious figure, but I just like to allude to the fact that that's how this man of sin is going to come, this son of perdition. He's going to come and people are going to believe him. People are going to be deceived by him. And even the people, the leaders, the people you think know the best, the people you think know it all, the people that are supposed to, you know, instruct you, they're going to be deceived. They're going to follow this man of sin when he comes. Not to say that this guy is the guy, but I'm just saying, like, as a prelude, you know, like that stuff. Yeah. That stuff is supposed to happen.
How I feel about it is, I don't. I'm gonna go left with it, and I'm gonna compare him with a cult leader, because I feel like if it's it starts with one, and then you have others, and it's a trend that where other people believe. Because, you know, David Kershens, I'm saying his name probably wrong, or Jim Jones, any cult leader, you have a group of people that are following you, and it becomes a trend. I only serve one God. I only know one God. You know what I'm saying? But you have people that believe in other things because that's their religion. And they're going to follow because if you convince yourself and you really try to divert from, you know, what's wrong, you're going to start to believe it after a while. And especially if you have other influences out there that are believing in the same thing, it becomes a strong trend. There's lost people out there that are looking for someone to, you know, take that lead in their mind. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I guess that's a good point. That'll be like social proof for others to say, like, look, I heard this guy, you know, he saved, you know, someone's daughter. Like, who? That guy over there? So it makes it, I guess, for those people, it makes it a little bit more appealing, because this person you can actually touch, feel, see, you know what I'm saying? As opposed to God, which is more so like in your spirit or in your mind. So, of course, people are going to be more drawn to a person that, like, an actual person, you know? So that was a good point, Mike, you know, just the social proof of it all. And they're actually being an actual person, you know.
There's a couple of other videos too, because there was one, like, to Levi's point, where, like, it was like I don't know if it was like an actual temple, but it looked like some kind of outdoor, like, you know, place of worship. And they had them in like what was considered like this high seat. And, you know, it was one chair and a whole bunch of people were surrounding him, standing and stuff. And then there was another video I seen too, where, like, they did some kind of like sacrifice of a heifer, and it was a big like bonfire burn. And then they burned like he sacrificed the animal. I guess he was leading out. And supposedly like, you know, the spirit of, it was supposed to be releasing the spirit of this red heifer or whatever. And I mean, not for nothing too. Oh, this is my third week saying that, but like, there's been other.
40th week. The 41st week.
And, but I'm more conscious of it now. I was watching the video. I mean, there's been like other events, like, you know, happening in Jerusalem too. Like, they brought in those three red heifers, like, around September or whatever, in preparation for like trying to rebuild the third temple. And like, and so they doing a lot of different things. And, you know, I don't know how much of it is just, you know, man trying to push the issue versus like, you know, these people seeing all these different signs and things that's happening in 2022. Cause this year, if we did a recap, bro, it's a lot of extraordinary like events that's happened this year for sure.
That's true. That's true. Now, I wanted, Lee, you brought up something a little while ago I wanted to discuss a little bit, but you kind of really set it off, really, is how do you know if what a false prophet is? By what signs can you look at to see that this person is not, does not have the truth in them, you know? And you talked about them. What's up?
If he sells water on BET at 2:00 in the morning. Tell you gonna pay your mortgage.
That's a false prophet.
Yeah. That's a false prophet.
I mean,
don't buy that water, man.
It's sure something different, but I wanted to bring up Matthew 24:24, right? It says, "For there shall arise false Christs and false prophets, and shall show great signs and wonders, insomuch that if it were possible, they shall deceive the very elect." And it made me think about the back in the time with Moses and the Egyptians and trying to get the children of Israel out of Egypt. And we know that Moses showed signs as he was given power and direction by God. But yet the magicians of Pharaoh were also able to do certain things. And so there's a couple of, I guess you could call them miracles that they did. So Moses made his staff into a snake. The Egyptians did the same thing. Of course, Moses' snake ate theirs, but nonetheless, they were able to do that. They also made the water appear as blood the same way that Moses did. And then one of the last ones that they were able to duplicate was the frogs that Moses brought upon the land. And after that, they couldn't hang anymore because it was just too much. But the point is, these people were doing these things either one of two ways, either through the power of Satan, which we know can turn himself into an angel of light. He has abilities. He's obviously not God, but he can do certain things and show certain signs. It's either that or through deception, the same way we see magicians today pull a rabbit out of a hat or things like that. There are things you can do to deceive the eye, right? So regardless, the point is that these people who were not of the truth were able to perform signs. So in the same way, again, we don't know this Shlomo Yehuda personally or anything like that. But if they're attributing miracles to him, I would just caution people about how
attributing
things can be done.
God.
Correct. Especially if he himself is not given the glory to God for it. Because from what I can tell, he's not coming out plainly and saying it's God making me do these things. So if there are certain miracles being performed, I think take that with a grain of salt, because not everything that's a miracle is of God.
For sure.
That's a good line.
And then the Bible also says too, to test the spirit, like, you know what I'm saying? Like, God has given us the spirit of discernment. Well, if we tapped in for real, we should have an element of the spirit of discernment. So it's like, you know, when you see certain things, like, it's going to either connect with your spirit or it's not going to connect with your spirit, depending on how connected you are to the spirit. And, you know, even those in those examples, like, I mean, as it's been said, like, all the prophets in the Bible automatically gave it up to God. Like, in anything that they did, you know, it was all praises to God, you know, for whatever it was. Even Jesus led by that example. And the Jews killed him because he proclaimed himself to be God. And you know what I'm saying? So it's, I mean, I don't know. In this individual, like, if a man was true, like, you got to give it back and return it to the Father. If not, then, you know where it's coming from.
Yeah. I think David actually, or DTH actually said a good point when he was talking about the king's, I guess you can say the king's prophets. And which I was reading, I'm going to share a scripture, but I was wondering, like, you know, why would a king want to have prophets? You know, what's the point of that? But then as I was reading it, I realized, like, he wants to have prophets because he wants to have an advantage. And the only reason why he will keep these certain prophets around is when they said good news of him, right? Of the things that they want to hear. So I just wanted to read 1 Kings 22, verse 8, and then I'm going to read 13 and 4 of 1 Kings 22. So let's see, 1 Kings 22, verse 8. So the king of Israel said to Jehoshaphat, there is still one man. Now, they're talking about the prophet here, right? Mm-hmm. Still one man, Micaiah, son of Imlah, by whom we may inquire of the Lord. But I hate him because he does not prophesy good concerning me. But
even that. Yeah.
So that's the one. And I want to read 13 and 14. Then a messenger said, who had gone to call Micaiah spoke to him, saying, now listen, the words of the prophets with one accord encouraging the king. Please let the word be like the word of one of them and speak encouragement. I think that was the one. I don't know if that was the one. Okay, let me read 14. And Micaiah said, as the Lord lives, whatever the Lord says to me, that I will speak. Right. So that's the one I wanted to touch on. Like, we have to realize, like, it's God's word. It's not what you want to hear. And right. And they was talking in these times, like, God was really upset with the people then. Right. And so there was this prophet that was saying, you know, don't worry, everything is going to be all right. But that's not the word that God was giving. So we have to realize, like, unless it's coming directly from God, whatever that word is, that person is a false prophet. Right. So.
And then the other thing, too, like, as you know, David mentioned the example with Moses and the staff, like, it just reminded me of another example in 1 Samuel 5 when the Philistines took the Ark of the Covenant and they brought it to the house of Dagon, and then they set it next to Dagon, and then they went back into the house the next morning, and Dagon was the deity or the god of the Philistines. And they went into the house the next morning, and Dagon was on his face on the ground, I think in front of the ark or whatever. And then the next day, they set it back in place again, and they came the next day, and the deity was on the floor again, but his hands and his head was cut off. Yeah. So it's like, you know, that's just another example again. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, they're going to come with the tricks, and they're going to fool, like, some, but they're not going to fool many. And, you know, like, that authenticity is always going to be a little different, so...
Yeah, what they say, big bank take little bank, like the true word of God will always reign above, right? You know, just like D said, that the prophets back then, yeah, they made the snake, but then was it Aaron? Aaron is the one that cast down the snake, right? But that snake ate the other snake, right? Because the word, once God is in the mix, I feel like I want to preach. But now, what's God in the mix, man? Is no comparison, man.
So. Yo, and then go ahead, my bad. Well, I was gonna say, because like I had asked y'all a question last week, and you know I don't really ask questions without knowing the answer or trying to go a place to it. No, but no. I asked y'all, like, you know, if y'all knew who the Nicolaitans were, and you know why God hated what they did, and you know they were a people who, you know, were once a part of the way. But then they had leaders who kind of deviated from, you know, the teachings of God and adapted some of these Roman principles and customs and started teaching it to the Christians, and they kind of like drew them out. So it's like that's a whole nother. And the Bible says, like, you know, pastors will be whipped with many stripes if, you know, they don't follow the word and they lead people astray. So it's one thing for you to be an individual and, you know, you're doing something and you're saying that you this and that and it's not aligned with the word. But once you start, like, pulling people away in droves like that in that example, and not to say 100% that's what it is, but if it is, then, you know, that's even more of, you know, a red button or a red flag when it comes to God.
Yeah, and that's what cult leadership is. You know, you're leading people away from the word, trying to influence it and twist it in your own fashion or own way. You know what I mean? I don't know. Look at, take the segment, for example. We were talking about it, but look at Benny Hinn and pastors like that. You know, you see how they try to deliver the word and everything like that. But it's not anything visual until you're knocking somebody down just by a touch, and that person shows on TV. You know what I'm saying? So,
I got a question. Yeah. Because a prophet, and somebody correct me if I'm wrong, is a person that has the teachings of God and pretty much telling others about it, right?
Yeah.
Is there a difference between a prophet and a pastor or a preacher?
So a prophet is supposed to be able to tell of things that's going to come in the future. Hence the term prophecy. Yeah. So if they're not giving you revelations of something that's going to happen in the future, then they're not a prophet. And then a lot of these people use the term so loosely, and you see like these commercial preachers that's just, you know, preaching like just money and finance, and like next year you're gonna get that house, it's gonna be paid off, you're gonna get that car.
That's what I was touching on. But it happens so much though. I don't mean to cut you. Go ahead.
But yeah, no, it's just that, like Joel Osteen, they had a problem with, you know, how he preached.
Because I asked this question because it just like Fortunato said, it happens a lot, right? Where you have some pastors or some preachers where they're more of a motivational speaker kind of type of, you know what I'm saying, where they just rile you up, get you excited, but it's like, all right, is this fluff or is this for real? Did you really get this word from God? Like, you know, and I don't want to call his name. I know we called his name before, but I seen this video of a famous pastor, right? And he said that I don't want to misquote. I think he said, "If you sin, you won't go to hell." I'm pretty sure. I think that's what he said. And when I seen it, I was taken back. I was just like, wait, what? And just like that, man, you can just cause so much confusion, especially for those who like really don't read their Bible, where they just come. Well, pastor said, you know what I'm saying? Pastor said, like, I, you know, because I sin, I'm good, you know, and it just caused so much confusion. So I'll let y'all jump on it.
Well, that's a problem these days. And just to take it back to, you know, the kings and back in the days, you had somebody that wanted to tell you good things. And therefore, if you wake up, because let's be honest, you know, he has some good messages, but I look at him as a social, or most of these pastors out here as a social media pastor, where they're only getting those moments of where they're able to continuously tell you good things all the time. Mm-hmm. You know, the word, the book has so much more than the good things that they're just telling you. So
what it sounds like, DJ and Michael Joseph, what y'all are talking about, 2 Timothy 4:3-4. It says, "For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but mm-hmm. after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears, and they shall yep. turn away their ears from the truth, from and sound shall be doctrine. Turned yep. unto fables." So what you're describing is just so prevalent now, man. Like, people don't, that's why I have a hard time. I'm big on personal responsibility. And that's not to absolve people who are purposely leading people astray, because they should not purposely lead people astray. But at the same time, people are in a place where they don't want the truth. They don't want it. And they have to, you know, I feel like you just have to be honest about it. Like, you can't keep blaming other people. Like I said, the person who's purposely leading you astray, he's not right to do that. But at the same time, like as the Bible described, people they're going to find what the person who's telling them the things they want to hear. And then they're going to follow that and say, oh, I'm not going to go to hell for my sin. Like, who wouldn't want to hear that, right? Like, but that's the thing. People, they want to hear what they want to hear. They don't want to be convicted of their sin. And so
I was going to say, that's absolutely right. I'll chime in here. Sorry, that's a technical difficulties. But when you talk about DTH, it's not even new. It's definitely getting worse, I would say, but it's not even new. If you look at the Israelites, you know, back in the day, they had prophets. They had Deborah, they had Gideon, they had all these prophets. And what they kept asking for over and over and over again, oh, we want a king, we want a king, we want a king like mm-hmm. the other nations, we want a king like the other nations. They simply just want it. They didn't want what the prophets were telling them. The prophets were telling them to follow God, follow the commandments, follow this, do that, do the right things. Nope, they wanted a king. They could just listen to that guy. That guy followed God, and basically they're all right under there. So it's the same kind of principle. Like people nowadays.
Yeah, that's a great example.
They just don't want to follow the authority of God. They don't want to listen to the authority of God. And if it comes from somebody with the authority of God, they'll go to somebody who doesn't have it.
Yep. And I seen something too that would, you know, kind of struck me. It was like, there's a difference between having a gift and having the anointing. Because, like, you know, a lot of these pastors have the gift of speaking. Like, I used to listen to my man Jesse Duplantis all the time because he could preach. But then, you know, I seen him drop something recently talking about that your jewelry should cost more than the place that you live.
Oh, yeah.
And then he's stunting with the Rolex on. And it's just like, you know what I'm saying? Then you got Jamal Bryant, who says that he wants to grow marijuana on the church grounds. And, you know, trying to use that to bring folks in from. for real though. Like, because, you know, that's the difference going back to, like, that's the difference between having a gift and being anointed. Because, like, people follow the gift, but there's a difference when you have an anointing. Like, when somebody, there's it, like, when two people can sing, you can have. But listen, you can have two people who could sing at church, right? One person can be gifted and they can do a good job, but when that person with the anointing get up there and start singing, it's a whole different feel. Like, it's everybody in the house gonna feel it, whether it's your first time, whether you come to church or don't go to church. When the person within the anointing starts singing or preaching, like, you could tell and feel the difference versus someone who's just gifted at doing what they do.
That's a good point, because everyone has been given gifts from God. And so there are great orators, people who can speak and galvanize the troops and inspire people to do certain things. But if you use that gift for the wrong purposes, you know,
personal reasons, all that.
Yeah, personal use or to not bring glory to God, you know, you have the gift, but you're not using it the right way. So that, I think that's a great distinction about just having a gift versus walking in your anointing, for sure.
Nah, I mean, just to piggyback on what y'all just said, I guess. Now you really gonna know when somebody really get on their knees and pray and fast and really take time to be with God, right? Whatever that gift is, it don't even have to be singing, man. Whatever your gift is, it's just always something different when the name of Jesus is involved, right? And involved in whatever you do. Like, when it's really dipped in that anointing for real, just like, I'm going to go back and say singing. Like, I remember this one young lady, you know, she was singing this song, you know what I'm saying? A good voice, but midway through, bro, I'm like, bro, like, she sing okay, but I just feel something in this song, man. And like, it's just different when it's just coming from a Holy Ghost filled water baptized Jesus in their life.
Hey, for real. Hey, but I want to take it like a slightly different direction, though, because it's like, you know, Jesus told the prophets, like, you know, these things that I do, you'll be able to do greater, right? Mm. And in a sense, we're supposed to be able to be tapped in and, you know, to be able to do certain levels of miracles. Like, I don't think it's outside of the believer to be able to perform miracles in a sense, you know, not of your own, of course, but through the power and, you know, the will of God. So it's like, where is that at? Because it's like, you know, we hear one person who's doing miracles and, you know, people just immediately refute it as like just false prophecy. Yeah. But like, you know, some, there should be a fragment of people and believers who still are connected enough to have that ability. That's like, what I And it's like, you know, I think we've mentioned this before, like when I was young, I remember, well, I think I mentioned it before, but just being young in the church, like in New York, it was probably like 5-6 years old. And, you know, just being able to remember, like, you know, brothers bringing in someone who is possessed.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, you know, like 6-7 brothers struggling to bring her in. But, you know, the pastors, the leaders is up front and, you know, they ready to go to work. And, you know, this young lady leaving different than how she came in. But you don't see none of that no more. Like, bro, nowhere. That's what I was saying.
Yeah. I was kind of saying earlier, like, bro, we are well aware of the evils that's out there. But there has to be an opposite side. That's why, like, I'm hoping that the brother that we was talking about earlier, Shlomo. Like, that's why I'm hoping Shlomo ain't with the same old, you know, story that we keep hearing, like false prophet. I'm hoping, like, okay, he's that other side, which, you know, it doesn't sound like
Jesus shadows work.
I don't know, but it's just like there has to be someone that's out here that is, taking up the mantle from Moses and Jeremiah and the prophets of the old. There has to be a modern day prophet out here, right?
Well, but see, the thing is, go ahead, DTH, because I'm coming right behind.
I was going to say, I don't think that these things are not necessarily happening anymore, even if it may not be as visible to us, because obviously the world is a big place. Right. There's certainly things happening outside of the United States of America. So who's to say that things aren't happening out there? But at the same time, I will say, you know, when we talk about miracles, right? I saw a little through a little research. There's a stat that there's roughly, I think, what is it? 150 or 250 miracles throughout the Bible between Abraham and Jesus, of Abraham and Christ. Death and resurrection, about 250. And that's a span of about 2,000 years. So on average, that would be one miracle every 8 years. Now, that's a long time, right? 8 years. But even then, it's not as if it was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, miracle. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, miracle. Sometimes there were hundreds of years that would pass before miracles were performed. And what I learned is that miracles are there to bring revelation, but there's not going to be revelation without confirmation. And so every time that something occurred, there was a reason why it had to be done at that time for the people at the time to absorb it and understand. So the thing is, the Bible even says that the miracles Christ did, they're written for our faith so that we can believe. Is to help our belief. So, you know, I don't know that miracles are going to today, that they're going to increase someone's faith. I mean, I guess it would be something interesting to see, and maybe it can build your faith a little bit, but I guess I would say that shouldn't be something for people to build their faith upon today, because you should build your faith upon the gospel of Jesus, right? So you shouldn't be looking to see, even if it's someone who's given glory to God and saying, hey, I just did this thing, but God did it. I don't think you need that for your faith to be strong, because everything is in the word, really. So, I mean, that's just kind of how I see it.
True. I mean, my only point was that, you know, we ain't, you know, at least from my experience, my 34 limited years in Church of God, like, it doesn't seem like that the power, the connectivity is the same as it was, you know, as mentioned in the Bible in the days of Pentecost, or even with Peter, there was like, you know, from the shadow of Peter, you know, people was healed. Like, so it's like, you know, and I think a lot of it also goes into like, you know, what just comforts and availability of a lot of different things that we have. And like, I was even reading the piece too, like I got to vet it a little bit, but it was like, it was stating like how all the disciples like died, you know, some kind of death. There was only one of the disciples that died a natural death. And I forgot which one it was, but it's like all of them kind of died in different ways mm-hmm. because they were, you know, preaching the gospel and spreading the word. So if that was the case and my man was like really out here, like doing God's work, like you don't think the CIA and other people would be hemming them up with all this CERN activity. They had a whole bull in Switzerland that they was, you know, kneeling to and doing ritual dances to and stuff. Like these people with power is not going to let like a man really about God's work just be publicized in this fashion when they're trying to suppress everything else.
You know, a part of it is too, though, is that the truth is, I think what you're probably getting at is like, we are further spiritually than the people in the past. And I think, I don't think that we're any less saved, right? But I do think it is true that, like you say, people are not as tapped in to the spiritual realm as those that came before. Because remember, these people, the distractions that exist today did not exist in the past. There was no such thing as social mm-hmm. media. They were not hustling to invest or not. And I'm not saying these are bad things, right? But they're not hustling to do to get their business going. They were
all these forms of entertainment.
Yeah, they were completely fully devoted to preaching the gospel, going everywhere. That was it for them. So like that's all they did. So but when you look at today, we do have the cares of life that get in the way from us really being able to be in our word and praying the, you know, as deeply as they did. Not to say that we can't do these things now, but it's true. I mean, there are different facts of life that are impacting us today that restricts us from being able to really have that ability that people once had. Again, not that we're less saved, right? If you have faith in Christ, you're saved by grace through faith. But the ability to do miracles in these things, I think if we did put ourselves under these kind of strict, living situations the way they did, we could probably do the same thing.
Perhaps. True. All right,
I only say perhaps because, like you said, it has to have confirmation. It has to be a reason why that miracle would be performed. But go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, and even on the confirmation part, really quickly, it's just like, you know, I mean, you know, I don't, it's not, it's a slight deviation, but like with the speaking of tongues, you know, which is, you know, a popular spot amongst. But I'm just saying it's the same thing. That's what the Bible says. Like if one speaks in tongues, like it should be, you know, interpreted. Like where there is an interpretation, the word says, like, you know, to hold your tongue and not to speak, because the people walk in your church, they're going to think these people are crazy. Like, you know, I'm paraphrasing, but that's what the scripture says. So, I mean, you know, in all things, there has to be confirmation and, you know, confirmed by one or two, but it's going to be confirmation for sure.
My God is a God of order. He doesn't do things in chaos.
That's right. You're right about that.
Hey, and the last thing I wanted to ask y'all too is like, you know, if he was, I guess, a false prophet, do you think he is like the false prophet, or do you think there's going to be many different variations of false prophets to try to like, you know, get different waves of people, torn away?
Oh yeah, I'll definitely hop in on that one. For me, I don't know if there's going to be one single false prophet, like a single. I know the Bible talks about the man of sin, the man of perdition, son of perdition, all that stuff. There probably will be a figurehead, but I personally think it'll be an entity. I think it will be a group. It'll be some kind of entity that they have now, and then that would be the really main people that are pushing this false doctrine, these false narratives. You know, the Bible talks about that there's going to be powers and principalities that we're going to fight against. We don't fight against flesh and blood. We fight against these spiritual wickednesses of high places. So I'm saying, So at this point, I think it's going to be an entity. It's going to be a group of people. There might be a figurehead, but it's going to be a couple. It's going to be an entity. That's what it'll be. I mean,
true.
Yeah. I don't really know for sure. I can't say whether it'll be one person or if he's it or whatever, but I think that it's interesting. I mean, if it doesn't seem like, just looking at the climate of the world today, there's a lot of people, obviously, there's a problem with speaking anti-Semitic speech. But at the same time, people disrespect the Jews all the time, like in their everyday talk with people. Like, I can't see everybody getting behind this Shlomo Yehuda. When I say everybody, non-Jews alike. So I don't know. I feel like it has to be someone from a different background that's going to be able to, you know, be likable for all people.
And yeah, I mean, and you know, as we've mentioned, well, as we mentioned, like the return of, you know, Messiah, the actual Messiah, Jesus returning, like one thing that, you know, which kind of like struck me, I was reading a prophecy in Daniel, and, you know, he had a vision of Jesus like way before, you know, Jesus came to being, and it matched entirely with the same vision that John had when he was on the Isle of Patmos and describing, like, you know, his arms and his legs being of that look like a fine brass. And, you know, his eyes of flames or whatever it was. So it's like when the Messiah returns, for sure, it's going to be confirmation, as we've illustrated over and over again. Like, there won't be like, you know, ifs, what ifs or ands or buts about it. Like, it's going to be a clear distinction that, you know, this is the Messiah, whether you know it for sure, whether you read the Bible or not. You know, just like I think the mark of the beast, like we've said that before, it's not going to be something where it's like you don't know like what it is. Like, you're going to have to lay it down and know that this is the image of the beast or the image that's not of God. So, you know, I don't think even in free will, you know, God is still awesome enough where it's like it's going to be clear. So, you know, not to confuse anybody on, you know, what choice you need to make. But, you know, very clearly, like, this is going to be it or it's not going to be it. So.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
All right. Well, I mean, we're going to go ahead and wrap this up, man. It's been another powerful hour. We talked a little bit about Shlomo Yehuda in Israel, who, you know, people are proclaiming to be the Messiah. You know, we're just going to stay tuned, keep our eyes peeled, man, and see how these things continue to develop. But as we know, just as we kind of continue to look back on 2022, there's been so many different events that has happened this year that has tied to the Bible in some kind of way, biblically, man. And so, you know, it's just setting the stage for 2023. And so, you know, as we go into this year and get ready for preparation of this new Roman year, you know, it's just always, as we say, man, keep your eyes open, stay vigilant, stay woke, make sure your relationship is intact with the Most High God, because, you know, time is winding down and you don't want to be caught on the outside of the ark when them doors shut and the rain starts coming. So this has been another episode of the Hold Your Point Podcast. We are the Hold Your Point Podcast crew. Make sure you like and subscribe on YouTube, Spotify, Apple, wherever you listen to us at. Watch us at. And until next time, man, we out of here.